My sisters and brothers, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of land that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. Jesus, tired from his journey, sat down there at the well. It was about noon. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How can you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink? For Jews use nothing in common with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you do not even have a bucket and the cistern is deep. When then can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this cistern and drank from it himself with his children and his flocks?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I shall give will never thirst. The water I shall give will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may not be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." The woman answered and said to him, "I do not have a husband." Jesus answered her, "You are right in saying, 'I do not have a husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you people say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Believe me, woman, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You people worship what you do not understand. We worship what we understand, because salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. And indeed, the Father seeks such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us everything." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one speaking with you." At that moment, his disciples returned and were amazed that he was talking with a woman, but still no one said, "What are you looking for?" or "Why are you talking with her?" The woman left her water jar and went into the town and said to the people, "Come see a man who told me everything I have done. Could he possibly be the Christ?" They went out of the town and came to him. Meanwhile, the disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat." But he said to them, "I have food to eat of which you do not know." So the disciples said to one another, "Could someone have brought him something to eat?" Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say, 'In 4 months the harvest will be here'? I tell you, look up and see the fields ripe for the harvest. The reaper is already receiving payment and gathering crops for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper can rejoice together. For here the saying is verified, that one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the work, and you are sharing the fruits of their work." Many of the Samaritans of that town began to believe in him because of the word of the woman who testified, "He told me everything I have done." When the Samaritans came to him, they invited him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. Many more began to believe in him because of his word, and they said to the woman, "We no longer believe because of your word, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Is the Lord in our midst or not? If we just take a moment to reflect back to 2 weeks ago, our first Sunday of Lent, our gospel reading, of course, was the account of Jesus venturing off into the desert for his 40 days. And today, with this first reading from Exodus, we find ourselves with the imagery and another desert moment. And I can't help but reflect, in light of these past 2 weeks, in light of our readings and this imagery of the desert, upon Ignatius of Loyola and upon his own desert moment. And many of you are familiar with the story of Ignatius and the cannonball at the Battle of Pamplona and his convalescence back home at Loyola. And brothers and sisters, we have 500 years of vantage points to look back on that moment and to look back and say, well, you know what? Everything turned out okay. It's all right. But not for Ignatius in that moment. In moment, after 30 years of being formed and being trained for one thing and one thing alone, ended abruptly on a single day at a battle in Pamplona. And we tend to think of him as gently convalescing and discerning. But brothers and sisters, I can't help but believe that he was experiencing incredible loss in that moment. And he was experiencing anxiety and anger in that moment. And I'm reminded of that because in many ways, this is our desert moment as well. As church, as globe, here on the hilltop, we're living in the midst of our anxiety, in the midst of our anger, in the midst of our sense of loss. The loss of our time here together physically on the hilltop. And in that desert moment, we know that Jesus was with Ignatius in the midst of, not outside of, his loss, his disquiet, and his anxiety. Ignatius, in being open, would respond in dreaming, in discerning new possibilities because of his personal loss, and in and with his anxieties. Ignatius was invited, was led to seek and find God in all things, even in the uncertainty of an incredibly tragic situation. This is what we are experiencing now. Is seeking and finding God in all things. It's a hallmark of Ignatius's own life pilgrimage. A few years later, along with his first companions, his friends, Ignatius would find himself with his companions a few miles outside of Rome on their way to meet with the Pope in a small town called Listorda. And some of you are familiar with what occurred. In that moment, he didn't know if he was going to get to Rome and meet with adversity or acceptance. But in that small chapel in Listorda, Ignatius had a vision in which he heard Jesus say to him, "I will be propitious to you. I will be favorable to you in Rome." And again, he didn't know what that meant in terms of adversity or acceptance, But what he clung to and recognized in that moment was that Christ was present with him and would remain present with him wherever he went on his journey. Again, facing great uncertainty, Ignatius knew that whatever the case, God would be with him and with his companions as well. I believe, brothers and sisters, in these moments, these desert moments, Ignatius exhibited a virtue that really is a hallmark of Ignatian spirituality and is really the only prerequisite that he invites retreatants making the spiritual exercises, the only prereq that one making the exercises must have is the virtue of magnanimity. Magnanimity, it's a big word, and it can mean a lot of different things, and I think just to break it down ever so slightly, and I credit my dear brother, Father John O'Malley, who instilled this understanding of Ignatian magnanimity in me. Because Father O'Malley would speak of, well, you have Cicero's understanding of the virtue of magnanimity, which is the striving for virtue, tempered with justice and a concern for the common good. And then you have Thomas Aquinas, whose understanding of magnanimity is a hope in doing great things and in accordance with God's deepest desires for each of us. Simply put, brothers and sisters, that's the motto on the wall above the stage in Gaston Hall that reads, Ad maiorem Dei gloriam inque hominem salutem. For the greater glory of God and for the service, for the salvation of humankind. That's magnanimity. That's who we are as church. That's who we are here at Georgetown. It's that spirit of magnanimity that we've already been living. These past years, these past months, these past days, and I've witnessed it in terms of the tears being shed as friends departed, in terms of incredibly moving, consoling, solace-providing reflections on the internet. Magnanimity. We weep and grieve from this spirit of magnanimity. We forge new opportunities rooted in love from this spirit of magnanimity. As we come to the table, brothers and sisters, we come together in that spirit of magnanimity. And as we do so, let us pray for one another, for ourselves, that we may continue to proceed through the loss, through the anxiety, through the solace and the consolation in an ever-deepening spirit of magnanimity, individually and collectively. And in doing so, live more fully out of that spirit of Christ's love, that is magnanimity in all things that we do, that we say, and that we are. Amen.